Thank you. Thanks for sticking around toward the end. Today I want to talk about our new database, Timescale. I'm the CTO of Timescale. I'm also a professor of computer science at Princeton. So hopefully I'll try to not get too academic in this talk. So the interesting thing, if you think about it, is databases emerge at this at an era for relational data, you know, going back to series to System R from IBM in the 70s. But since then, we start seeing them used in much broader areas. And one of the things that we're starting to see emerging is that timescale data is everywhere. Between IoT and financial and DevOps, the interesting thing about it is that the volumes of data that we're starting to see are much greater than anything before. And this has kind of happened because of a bunch of different technology trends. One of them is that we're starting to see more ways to capture data from sensors and IoT devices, to servers. We have fatter pipes to backhaul all this data to a centralized data center, and now cheaper storage to actually store it over longer periods of time. And I think we're starting to see with the time series analysis because it's powerful. You can do this to look at the past, understand what happened, understand the present, and many applications where we're trying to do things like predictive analytics to think about or plan to think about how we're going to use the future. The problem, and why I'm here going to talk about today, is that means that we need time series applications are different than what we've seen before. And so if you think about a banking application, I'm going to come back to this, you know, even if you're a Bank of America, you might have something like 100 million users. And so maybe the primary table of your database might be 100 million rows. They could be long rows. But if you think about a streaming application, so again, I'm at Princeton University, you don't think a campus would have that many different streams of data. Princeton's campus has 180,000 streams just coming off of its buildings, right? And so the amount of data that we're starting to see, in fact, this room, it depends how new it is, but you could generally see a lot of these things are now connected. So we're starting to see streams of data coming from everywhere, and we're seeing this high volume of data. We are trying to do these things for real-time analytical applications. And not only do we want to do that, but we want to often tie these data streams, these time series streams, across across the enterprise. So you might do that from anywhere from DevOps. You might tie it into product and marketing, customer service. And so the question is, how do we build infrastructure to make this easy? Well, you could say, just use a database. And we have actually a funny story. Why we started doing this, we were initially looking, we're not that new a startup. We're initially building an IoT platform. And so we really faced this problem. We wanted to handle a high volume and high velocity of data. And the problem we encountered is that a lot of existing databases weren't really suited to this. Relational databases, Postgres, very much a fan of, really easy to use, solid, reliable, great ecosystem, but typically hard to scale. On the flip side, we have all these new NoSQL databases, which, if anything, sell their scalability, but you give up a huge amount of query power and the ability to support types of queries with that. So in some sense, I said we felt this pain because we sat around trying to build this type of platform, and nothing out there kind of fit what we need, so we set out to build it ourselves. And eventually, we decided that was a bigger opportunity, which is why I'm kind of here to talk about Timescale today. And in doing so, we kind of needed a bunch of different properties. We wanted our database to be time series-centric. We wanted to be able to support this large volume and velocity of data. We wanted to be able to perform basically full SQL. We wanted to perform very complex and performant queries, easy to integrate into our existing workflow, and in some sense easy to operate, take advantage of a rich ecosystem like Postgres has. So that's what we decided today, and that's kind of what I want to talk about. Interestingly, Timescale is actually built and packaged as a Postgres extension. So you could incorporate it into your existing Postgres databases. Just create an extension, and it could run against parallel to the rest of your data. So what are the three properties that we actually wanted from this? So the first is that we wanted this to be horizontally scalable. So we want to support high write rates, both within a single node and also across a cluster of nodes. We wanted to perform a bunch of distributed query optimizations for performant complex queries. We wanted this to be reliable, and a lot of that we're able to basically leverage the existing 20, 25 years that Postgres has, and easy to use. Again, supports full SQL. We don't want to be like a SQL-like language that some of these NoSQL databases do, which are really good if you have a key value lookup, but throw in a complex WHERE clauses and they can no longer even do that. And so you could ask, you know, why haven't a lot of people been trying to build, you know, why hasn't this been done before, or why is this hard to do in the first place? You know, why doesn't Postgres just solve this today? And I think this really comes back to the roots of what we actually developed these databases for. And so, as many of you know, they were designed initially to solve the problems of online transaction processing, OLTP. And so if you think about it, one way is that they were designed for a particular workload that was different in nature than what we have with time series workloads. And so by thinking, we're not trying to solve the general problem, we're trying to solve the specific problem of time series databases. So we were able to make a bunch of architectural decisions that you wouldn't make if you're trying to solve this in the general case. So in particular, if you look at traditional databases, there's really, if you look at the workload, think about, again, this banking application. It's much more common that people actually move money in their bank than a bank gets a new user, right? So what does it mean? You have a million customers or 100 million customers. You move money from one account to next. It's updating one row and writing it to, you know, crediting from one row, debiting from one row, and crediting another row. So what there actually are is that in traditional OLTP workloads, we actually see that updates, not inserts, are common. And in particular, you often get a random access patterns across the various rows of your database. There might be some locality, but in more and more things, we're actually starting to see, you know, people send money all around the world. So this leads to two challenges, right? It leads to challenges for scaling on single machines, and it leads for challenging scaling across multiple machines. And what we'll see is why this is different with time series data. In particular, one of the big problems of scaling on a single machine is that this individual row starts to get, or this individual table starts to get quite large. And as your table grows large, your indexes no longer fit in memory. And so often what's going to happen is when you're even trying to, let alone query, but even when you're trying to insert, in your inserts, if you're trying to maintain these indexes in real time, you're going to often be swapping back and forth to disk, right? And so there's two ways to design this. So the problem is you need to write, and these are to a random entry. So this is effectively means that you're going to be updating sorted locations in your B-tree, right? So you have two options. If you use a hard drive, the problem is this means it's going to seek. That's 5 or 10 milliseconds for every time you're trying to do these inserts. Or if you're using a flash drive, you know, these are supposed to be faster, SSDs. You know, if you start looking deeper, what happens with SSDs, while reads might be particularly a bit faster, writes could only write at a page granularity. So if you try to update one cell in an SSD, what it actually is doing is reading an entire page from disk into you know, your flash memory, which is about 8K in modern SSDs, modifying that one cell and then writing it back. So that means if you want to update basically 4 bytes, you're ending up, your I/O throughput is 8K in and out of the disk. And there's limited number of cycles they could do. So people have attempted to address this. And there have been a number of interesting ways in the last decade to address this update problem for both of these hard drives and SSDs. In particular, if you look at a number of new, different type of architectures, such as LevelDB or the new backend for Mongo, they use a particular data structure very different from a traditional relational database. And that is called a log structured merge trees. And what this is basically doing is, remember, the problem that we had before is that these small writes became very expensive. So what they say is, let's actually try to eliminate small writes at all. This, in some sense, goes back to like LFS, log-based file systems from the 90s, that we basically keep the latest updates in memory. And only after we build enough batch in memory, we have this sorted in memory, we write it as one big batch to disk. And that stays as a sorted table on disk. Now, the problem is, these are immutable, so you don't have this update problem. But the problem is, now you have all these overlapping batches at once. So then you have this other garbage collection process where you merge them together, you resort them, write them out, and so forth. The problem is, unlike a B-tree or something, there's not this great index all your data. So you end up needing to keep a lot of indexing memory to figure out which of these batches are actually stored in your data. In fact, even all updates and deletes are just diffs. You don't actually ever replace a data that's even deleted. You just write a tombstone to the latest copy in memory, and then write that to disk. So we end up building very big indexes, and we need to maintain them in memory. And so the cost has come out. They are very efficient in terms of use of the underlying storage. But a cost is that there's really weak support for a lot of things that you might want from your relational database, like secondary indices. There are various ways people have done that. Sometimes people put a thin veneer of SQL on top of these that is translating basically to a full table scan on disk, or they have a bunch of ways to pack together a bunch of what appears to be a bunch of different secondary indices into the way they encode the key. So for example, in Influx, they have the problem that the index grows with the cross product of the cardinality of the columns. Let me unpack that for a minute. You know, if you have a million different devices and you want to keep an index on that million, add 1,000 locations, and they have 10 firmware versions. That's still a pretty small database. Right there, that means that your index in memory is going to have 10 billion entries, right? So you're going to quickly find yourself running out of memory. And as you know, memory is about 20x the price of SSD and about 100x the price of hard drive. So that wasn't really giving us what we initially wanted. But it's a great way to make SSDs more scalable for OLTP workloads. Now the second part, that was one of the challenges that people have addressed with scaling out on single machines. The second part is, how do we actually scale out to many machines? Well, there's the old trick is, and we hear about this a lot, is use partitioning or sharding, right? You take one server where you might have the primary key across that server, and you want to add more servers, you're basically splitting it out. And as you add more servers, you further partition the workload, you move some of the data, and you kind of supposedly elastically scale it out to the number of machines you want. In practice, you don't actually do it kind of lexicographically like I show here, but you use some type of hashing of the key space or using something richer like consistent hashing. Now the problem is this actually is basically the hammer that we have for most of it to scale, but if we've gone back to OLTP workloads, most of these updates are still to random keys. So what actually happens is you actually often need to do then transactions across these different partitions across nodes. So we actually return to a lot of more heavier weight mechanisms, like doing something like two-phase locking across these machines in order to run any type of transactions. And if you want this to be highly available, you even each of these himself is replicated. So if you look at Spanner, there's actually two levels of this. So every time you grab a lock, this is actually an operation to a consensus group in three nodes. So doing one transaction might translate to something like 27 operations to underlying nodes, 27 different nodes. So this seems like it's hard, and you could say, well, maybe that's why we've had such trouble building these truly distributed databases for so long. And what I'd like to pose is that actually time series data are different. And so you could think about architecting them quite differently. In particular, if you look at OLTP workloads, they're primarily update heavy, while time series databases are insert heavy. If you think about OLTP, we often write to random locations in these tables, when in time series, we typically write to the recent time interval. Again, if you think about streaming data from all of these 100,000 different sensors, or even financial tick data, you know, you can occasionally get old updates, but most of it's the market, or it's the current state of the world that's coming into your database. In OLTP, we have transactions to multiple primary keys, when in time series, we often have data that is both naturally partitioned across time, because of this property, and space. Again, financial, these different tick streams in sensors, the sensors themselves form a natural partitioning over your data. And so in some sense, if we look back on how this might mean for our architecture, we could start to see some of the glimmers of how we're going to set around to design timescale. So in particular, if you go back to think about how we're actually doing writes, so again, the streaming application, we're collecting data from many sensors, it's coming into our database, new data all the time, what we start to see is that this is what I actually meant by it's giving you this natural partitioning across time and space. So from the beginning, at its core, we're designed with a type of multi-dimensional partitioning, and in particular, usually two-dimensional partitioning, one against time dimension, and two against some type of spatial or primary key dimension. And the system in particular, unlike, let's say, you could say, well, doesn't Postgres 10 give you partitioning? Don't a lot of databases give you partitioning? One of the differences, we're not typically thinking about this as a hard-coded in the primary ID space where you're just hashing it. What the system is in the write path, it is, as I'll show you, it is giving you the illusion as if this is just one giant table. And even in the insert path, is dynamically figuring out if this is actually going to fit an existing partition, if it needs to create new partitions, and make that all completely transparent to the user. And not only do you want to size the, not only do you want to define them in a static way, but the system wants to actually adapt their partitioning based on even observed size, because the size of your time, of the amount of data you're collecting can change over time. And so, as I'll talk about, you want to make sure that not only are they aligned by time, but they want to be sized in the right way to be able to keep the recent intervals efficiently in memory and avoid that swapping to disk part that we ran into before. Yeah? Yeah, so the way we actually implemented this used Postgres, I mean, we internally their own, but it actually is, these are actually all child tables of this parent table. And so the nice thing about this design is that we actually allow you to, under the cover, see all these individual tables themselves, and you could actually manage them like they're normal Postgres tables. Though, for most perspective, the way we're designing is you could actually manage the parent table, and then actually a lot of these things will be inherited to the child table. But as I'll say, we also do a bunch of distributed query optimization. So our query path is not just going to be doing what is stock Postgres with child tables. So this brings me, and so not only this then on one node, this is actually is how you actually do a scale out version 2, that this gives you a way to partition this data across many servers, although we also allow you to do things like make time intervals sticky to the same nodes, which is a common, which commonly gives you performance benefits that we see in a lot of standard work, standard type of queries that we see. So again, think about this is how you would divide yourself by time and space, and then to follow on your question, what we find our design is we actually want to handle a lot of this automatically. So our partitioning, what we see is both opinionated and automated. New chunks are automatically created in the insert path, and it handles a bunch of potential deadlock issues, out-of-order data issues, and local indexes are often a conjunction of this time and the various values, and sometimes basically based on the cardinality, you index them in slightly different ways. The other thing which I was alluding to answer your question is that unlike you know what you do in standard database partitioning, ours has a particular flavor in that we also want chunks to have an approximate max size while also taking into account that you could have late data arrive into your system. So you want to think about what it is during normal time periods, but also you want to give yourself some buffer and you want to handle the fact that you might have out-of-order data or even early data appear as well. So in particular, we size them in a certain way to be able to maintain these indexes from recent chunks fully in memory. And what this means is, of course, is that when we, on the insert path, we could then update these indexes just in memory and not need to swap to disk, which is going to give us a lot of performance benefits. But we also want to make them time aligned. And what that, the reason time alignment is important is we, for example, if you only did it by size, then you run into the issue that data that arrives early could push out a time interval, and that if other data comes in, that individual chunk could become too large. This also, so you have to balance that carefully. It also allows you to do nice things like enable retention policies, like delete data more than a certain time period old, because this will actually translate to dropping entire chunks, which is dropping tables or files on disk, which is, of course, much more efficient than deleting in-place rows. And so effectively, you run ourselves without actually doing vacuuming on these tables. Because you know, we do that with an approximate data retention, so we could translate that all to dropping tables, again, as opposed to deleting in-place data. The second thing this actually allows us to do is, now that we manage this and actually keep various constraints about the data that is found in each of these chunks or each of these tables, this lends itself to a number of distributed query optimizations that we're able to do. In particular, for example, a very a basic one that, though, gives a lot of performance benefit is to avoid querying certain chunks at all to answer queries via form of constraint exclusion analysis. So, for example, this simple query, if you know, for example, of course, the time constraints on these various tables, you never have to touch the other chunks that are outside these time intervals. Similarly, this is, again, two natural times of types of queries you often see in time series analysis, one which is slice across a number of different sources, but with some time bound. Another common one is dig deep on some of your data streams. So maybe look at one over a lot longer time period, but now deeper on this. So again, this gives us a form of constraint exclusion analysis, so we don't need to ever touch the other tables or even contact the other servers when we're in a distributed setting. Because all of the servers act homogeneously, so any of them could basically support both the insert path and also the query path. So they have knowledge about all the other constraints on the tables in the cluster. We also do, I introduce a number, this is actually one optimization that Postgres does, which is a type of online merge append. For example, if you want to do something like give me some data, order by time, descending limit 100, what Postgres will do is it could take multiple chunks or multiple partitions, and it could incrementally walk through them. It doesn't need to grab the entire, you know, do the full table scan first, compute the order, and at the end do the limit. What it actually could do is, if you have this type of query, it could go through multiple of these chunks in parallel and look at the last value that comes off of each chunk and then compare them against each other. So if you want to do order by whatever, limit 100, it could look at the newest value on each, see which one is the greatest, take that one, the one chunk gives me the second value, I compare the second versus first to the first, and keep doing that until I hit my limit, and then I can move on. This is particularly useful, this particularly saves you time when you actually have a rich predicate, such that getting the next value off that chunk could actually involve scanning a lot of that chunk. One way that we extended this, which is again very particular to time series analysis, is that we actually extend this to work with time aggregates. So you could specify something like, give me some aggregate over a time period, group by hour, order by hour, descend, give me the maximum time, the maximum temperature for a particular device for every hour over the last 24 hours, and this is going to make sure that it only incrementally processes individual chunks in order to figure out how I could compute that result. And there's another number of distributed query optimizations we do for this, perform partial aggregates on this distributed data, avoid full scans, for example, again, a common monitoring application, tell me the last K readings from every device in my system, right? That's really hard to express efficiently in SQL. That could often be a full scan until the end of time, until the beginning of time. And we give a bunch of optimizations and store metadata that makes this efficient. Because again, our focus is on time series data, both on the architecture and the type of analysis you want from that, different from general OLTP. Yep. Go ahead. We run a 9.6. We're an extension for 9.6. And I was alluding to this already. One of the key design choices we wanted to make was we want to give the users the illusion of a single table. And so what this means is that when they actually perform selecting, it looks like they're interacting with a single table. And also on the insert, they can insert a single row or entire whole batch of data, but just treat it like it's a single table. And so for example, I said before, we kind of act, every node acts similarly. So if you have a cluster with n servers, you can give that batch to any of them. And inside the node that actually accepts that insert, it not only will it figure out how to route the data to the right table, but also it'll take your batch, it separate them into sub-batches, and then it'll insert each sub-batch into the right table with a minimum of locking and avoiding, and doing a number of things to avoid kind of deadlocks. And furthermore, the engine is actually automatically closing and creating these chunks as part of the insert path. So this is not a thing after the fact that runs that is then going to occasionally kind of vacuum up your data and split it out and garbage collect. This is something that actually happens in line. And so the last key design point, which is perhaps more appropriate for a different audience than this, but was that we were designed up from Postgres. So the advantage is that you could actually connect to it and query it like it's Postgres and actually manage it like it's Postgres. As an extension, we basically tie into the query planner and execution engine with the various hooks that Postgres extensions gives us. But if you collect later, each of those chunks are actually internal Postgres tables, and so it'd be able to be managed in much the same way. So what that means is that from an administrative point of view, a lot of things become easier. in that we could use all the existing techniques we have from replication, and some of the stuff we saw in Postgres 10 for logical replication, for example, we'll certainly check them out, and seems like something you might be able to tie directly into the system without a lot of effort. You get checkpointing and backup, you get all this fine-grained access control from Postgres, and this is kind of what we inherit really from the great ecosystem that Postgres has. And the final thing is, if you think about most time series database, they went off this line of building these NoSQL databases and define their own query language, which means that every time you want a connector, you actually generally had to write it. You had to write your own integration for every third-party system. And often you'd use these in applications where I talked about integrating with workflows. It's not only used for, you know, it's used across an organization. So your DevOps people might want to stick Grafana on top of it or write to it via something like Collect-D, while your analysts or your product people might want to use Tableau to understand their data. And this stuff just all works out of the box because we just speak Postgres, even in the distributed case. Okay. The last thing that Postgres gives to us is that it, unlike most time series database, it allows us to avoid data silos. Typically, what people do in most time series databases, and this would perhaps, I know this is strongly a Postgres community, but when you're adopting some type of NoSQL database, you have two choices. You either denormalize your data at write time, so you keep a lot of metadata in every row of your database, which, of course, is very inefficient. It is often expensive if your metadata mappings change because you have to go back and update it. And is operationally difficult because it means that you kind of need to know that metadata. You have to almost do the join in application space before it's inserted into your database at all. And the second option is that you could basically, and what most people seem, or a lot of people seem to do, is you actually create separate databases. Your metadata is stored in a relational database, and your time series database is stored in like a NoSQL database. And then you push the problem on to application developers to join the data. Right? That works okay for developers. It's a pain. One of the whole reasons we have a database is to handle these data management problems. It's also a real pain for your business users. Because now if I want to say, you know, give me the time series data for like Mike's sensor or your customer service for John's toy, my time series database doesn't know anything about John. I need to go to one system, get John's toy's UUID, then use that UUID to query my time series database. Because, again, we're built on top of time scale, of Postgres, you could just use SQL joins with us against relational tables. So you could perform SQL joins inside the database itself or via the foreign data wrapper interface to an external database. Within the database, data is fetched either depending upon if the data is rapidly changing and it can be large, you would store that relational table on one of these nodes and you do a join against it. If that data is relatively small or very or quite immutable, you could actually use triggers to materialize that table on all the cluster nodes and then perform joins locally. We do not yet support joins. Well, we support them, just not efficiently, joins between hypertables, although it's something that we are working on. And because we're an extension, actually creating these tables and migrating is quite easy. Like I said, we currently are in Postgres 9.6. And really, after you install the extension, you just create a table. You know, it looks like a normal Postgres table. And call this one line, create hypertable. This is the name of the table. The column that is your time index. You could use not just timestamps, but you know, ints and whatever. And a partition key, or your space identifier. And right now, we kind of have you specify the number of partitions you'd like to build from it. Migrating data is similarly easy. Just insert into this database or use a copy command or a pgdump, insert into this table from your old table. And this would be basically sufficient. If your old data had this schema, would be sufficient for moving data into it. So that what we've encountered is a lot of times people start with a Postgres database because it's great when they have time series data, and then eventually they hit a certain scale and say, uh-oh, this no longer works for us. Let me try to figure out some crazy, you know, Mongo setup that makes this work. And what we're saying is now you could actually continue to scale with Postgres, use your same schema in time scale as you used before, and then just, you know, migrate to us via this simple command. So I did want to leave you, though, with some performance graphs. The interesting thing is we really designed this from the start to be for a clustered setting. And what we came to realize is, A, there's actually a lot of people that also run are good enough on single node. So we didn't necessarily know, because we weren't really thinking from the start about scaling on a single node. But interestingly, we found that it actually gave you really nice performance benefits, even if your data set is only large enough to need a single node. And particularly, these are for different reasons. So in clustered versions, you can actually get performance benefits because, you know, you're reducing your latency by parallelizing these queries over many nodes. And you could also reduce network traffic because a bunch of our distributed query optimizations and the way we push down different queries to the nodes means that, for example, you're not going to need to copy the full tables back to the one node that issues the query and join them there. You can do aggregation pushdowns. The way you do partitioning, you're basically localizing group bys onto nodes, and so and some of those, you know, those time aggregates, again, you're minimizing the amount of data that you need to send back. But even on single servers, we get benefits for really three ways. One of the biggest ways we get them is based on the way we carefully size chunks, as I talked about before. But also some of the optimizations, like merge appends and group bys, because they're localized to the chunks, you again avoid touching a lot of the data, and you could also parallelize across disks. So let's look at actually what happens with vanilla Postgres. This is Postgres 9.6.2 running on a fairly beefy instance running on Azure with premium SSD storage. And Postgres is working, you know, pretty good at, this is inserting rows one by one. I have batched in a couple slides. But one by one, you're getting about 14,000 inserts per second. Each row here has about 10 columns. And unfortunately, once you hit about 50 million rows, which is actually could be really large for a relational database or for like an OLTP database, but you know, on the smaller side for many time series applications, what you see is this performance drops down. And in particular, the striking thing about it is the rise of the variance, right? So these are individual, the performance every 20 seconds. The average is the average insert rate every 20 seconds. We do sometimes have stuff that still gets around, you know, 12,000 inserts per second, but there are a lot of time periods where you're down in the couple hundred inserts per second. On average, you might be down 8. But actually, if you're thinking about a production workload, you know, what you're often really cared about is how does, is not even just what the average does, but how does it work in certain scenarios? Because, of course, whenever you're down to these periods where you're a couple hundred inserts per second, you're now growing up queuing deeper and deeper behind you. So this kills you a lot more than the average. This is time scales performance in comparison. So I think this morning, this was from a couple, 2 or 3 weeks ago. This morning, one of our engineers wrote us that we were up to about 12 and a half. So we were actively narrowing this gap via a number of the chunk-based optimizations that we generally did. As an extension, our fast path is implemented all in C, and a bunch of the management stuff is implemented in PG SQL. But you know, it's a C, various parts of the things that we're optimizing to narrow this gap. But the striking thing is how this is basically constant performance up to, and I think we ran out this to about 250 million rows with very small variance. Now you could say, well, you're only using 4 gigabytes of memory. Let's throw some more memory on here. So then you could raise it to, let's say, 16 gigabytes of memory on your one node. And it pushes out this problem, right? But you're still running this problem. You run out of memory, you start swapping disk, and then Postgres is, again, going over the cliff. So with a single node, you could scale out by trying to throw more and more memory out there, and that's just pushing out your problem. And the question is, could you think about a different architectural design to really solve the problem? And that's what we think timescale gives you. The interesting thing is that this is writing row by row. In a lot of production settings, you might have some type of queuing system before you're actually database. That could be because you're writing data into your database through some logging system, a queuing system like Kafka, because you have some streaming engine that's pushing data to it. And typically, you might insert data, as you know, for efficiency more than an individual row at a time. So instead, and this is what some of the other time series database have what numbers they've used. So we insert, or inserting data instead at batches of 10,000 rows. And now, in absolute terms, we've gone up from about 15,000 inserts per second to about 150,000 inserts per second. Again, this, or 140, this is 10 metrics, so this is about 1.4 million metrics per second. And this, again, pushes out the problem a little bit with Postgres, but we again see this performance cliff at, you know, 50 to 100 million rows. We start really dropping down. And so out here, Postgres is getting, I think, on average, 8,000 inserts per second, while TimeScale has continued to maintain basically constant throughput across that time period. So that's on the insert path. A number of the query optimizations we're doing, and I think it's still early in terms of the query optimizations we could achieve, but at a high level, they go from, as far as we found so far, we performed no worse than vanilla Postgres, and there are certainly many cases where we could perform significantly better. So these are, you know, various types of things where, you know, some of the benefits they're getting are from localizing group buys. And this last one, where we get almost a 5x improvement over vanilla Postgres, this was the time aggregation problem I was talking about before. You know, select per minute the maximum reading, group by minute, order by minute descending, give me the last couple entries. And so this is actually an inquiry you could ask at any time interval. Like, you know, what are the last 5 minutes of February? What is the you know, the readings from them, right? And so this is kind of a general type of optimization we could do, and even running on a single node gives you some significant performance benefits. Now, I do want to say that we were designed with a particular use case in mind. We wanted full SQL. We wanted complex queries. And so, you know, I think it's good that if we're completely frank of when you should not use TimeScale, right? And so you should not use TimeScale. You could, but there are other things that are more optimized than TimeScale is. If you have very simple read requirements, if you really just want a key value store, or if you want to do something that column stores are really designed for, and I think this is very much aligned with what David was talking about earlier today, which is if you just want to roll up on one column, you know, a columnar format would be much more efficient. Or similarly, because of the columnar format, if your highest priority thing is compression, an architecture like that might be more important. Although there are some things, like we heard about earlier today, that you could improve the compression of basic Postgres' row storage thing. If you also have very sparse, for a lot of the same reasons, if you have very sparse or unstructured data, Postgres is probably, or TimeScale is probably not appropriate. And, you know, this is one of those, you know, what are your greatest weaknesses, and you turn it around. So if you're happy with experimental infrastructure, you don't need something like TimeScale. But if you want full SQL, you have complex predicates or aggregates, you want joins of relational data, you need to think about scale-out storage, you want rich indexing that doesn't fit in memory, you're dealing with mostly structured data, and you want to basically leverage the Postgres ecosystem, we think that TimeScale is allows you somewhat to have your cake and eat it too for time series data. So 3 weeks ago, we actually, we've been running an hosted version for about 6 to 8 months with some customers. But a few weeks ago, we actually open sourced the TimeScale, released under the Apache 2 very permissive license. You can get it on GitHub. Right now, the beta release is just a single node with clustering coming soon. There's also a fairly technical white paper you could find. I think actually we'll have some copies around here if anybody is interested, but you could also find it on our website. Otherwise, check it out, download it, give us some GitHub stars if you want, and I'm happy to take questions. Thanks.
So for the spatial partitioning,
yep.
Do you support more than a single column? Do you support like a composite spatial key?
So there's two different things. I think you should be able to define your partitioning key on... just to be clear, I use the word spatial because I like the time and space, but you're not talking about something like a GIS column. You're talking about, yeah. So I think you should be able to define this on a composite column, but there's two different things. Remember, it's primarily a scaling feature, right? And so the reason for partitioning is just to give you this natural scaling. You're able, of course, to always define your where clauses on any of these columns. So you're not limited to indexes. I mean, you could index any column, and we support Postgres's full indexes. What the reason you choose your partitioning column in a certain way is it allows you to do various things that eliminates the need. It's that constraint exclusion analysis, right? You'll have to, the only reason to do that is if this is the very natural way where your query is like, you often ask about devices or about, if you're, you know, you're yourself a multi-tenant company, that partitioning key might be your own clients or your financial data. So it's really about performance, and you could index any table. Yeah, that's what we do. We do the latter. Yeah, so we've rewritten. I should say the guy who actually wrote this is staying in the back, Matt. But he could give you the nitty gritty. But like I said, we rewrote part of the query planner and execution engine. We are on your insert path. We are taking the inserts, calculating which ones to do it in. So we probably do there the same as Greenplum would. Yeah, so we do keep metadata that tells you exactly where and how you need to execute the thing. There are similarities with what Citus is doing. I think in general they're trying to solve the broader data warehousing problem. So you know maybe they talked to the guys, you know, nice guys, talked to them yesterday. They're might be trying to do things like global indices on tables, which you might for a lot of traditional data warehousing queries, when isn't naturally a time series analysis. So there's really two aspects of it. One is the time series part that's going to give you this that we did so far, which is about architecturally, and what we're actually developing now is also a lot of extra support for types of queries that you might do with time series that are particular to that setting. And so point in time analysis, merging time series, a lot of things that are, again, are specific to time series. We'll see. We haven't looked at that closely yet. I mean, I think in general, their partitioning, like I set that by saying we are opinionated. You know, like a lot of the web frameworks say they are opinionated frameworks. We have a very particular use case in mind. Most database partitioning don't have that same time component, or that's not only what they're solving. So we're doing a bunch of things that are much more specific slash advanced for the ways we're doing partitioning. So there might be some underlying mechanism that we end up rewriting some of our stuff to use them, but I don't think they would at all replace the types of mechanisms we're doing for partitioning.
Do you have global indices?
We do not. So that is one thing that is one way where we are different from a traditional, we do not enforce something like a global uniqueness constraint, right? So we do not support global indexes because, again, in time series, that generally doesn't make sense. Right? You're not saying something like, I want to only insert a UUID once into my database. What you're often saying is, I'm collecting a stream of data from this UUID. None of the benchmarks here are from with OS tuning, as far as I know. As an open source package, we're going to expect people to install this locally, and we'll of course come out with some recommendations on what we think would be appropriate. But this is the stock cloud VM that you can tell those performance numbers from. So that's the question was, how does Timescale compare versus other time series databases in terms of memory storage, speed, whatever. This is a, so the answer is yes. I joke that because there's not, you know, this is a really multi-dimensional answer based on your usage scenario. So for example, if you're a column store, you will do single roll-ups faster, generally, and you'll probably get better compression. But if you start having multi-dimensional, lots of different columns, you sometimes can't even support that query. So for example, I think in Cassandra, a lot of times you do a where clause, and this could turn into a full table scan under the covers. Or in influx, you can't actually specify an order by after a group by. Or influx, again, doesn't index numerical columns at all. So if you want a numerical column, that's going to be a full table scan, right? So the answer is it very much depends on the query. And so if you find yourself running complex queries, this is going to be good for you. If all you want are individual rollups, probably a column store could be more efficient. So far we've published some of our benchmarks against vanilla Postgres. We're in the background, obviously benchmarking other things, and we're put up some numbers in the near future. Hold on, let's get a new person. With most SSDs.
But the example you gave of 4 bytes doesn't make sense in terms of B-trees because they're based on pages.
I guess the question is if you are updating a B-tree, well, here's the question, right? That whole page is going to be marked as dirty if you update any bit in it, right? And the answer is when you write it back to disk, it's going to be writing the entire thing. In general, I mean, you're right. In some sense, the B-tree structure, you're going to be updating in memory when you can. But there's a reason why a lot of these modern architectures move towards something like LSM trees. And one of the reasons is, yes, if you take your, in some sense, B-tree have moved this problem from the flash memory to now the OS, that if you want to update one cell, you'll have to read out that B-tree page, update it, and then if it gets evicted from main memory, it's going to write the whole block back to disk. So it's still a few bytes update is going to turn into a page write. So no matter what, you're paying the cost of a page write. Sorry?
It would be a page write of 8K.
That is caused by updating 1 byte.
Okay.
And so I guess you're right. The page write is you're going to see this, even though you're trying to only update 1 byte, you're going to see this as an 8K write. If it's on the flash or if it's in the B-tree, you're still going to see 8-page write, and that's at least one of the reasons that LSM trees have changed that around. But again, with one of the reasons that we design the way we are is to keep all these blocks in memory so we're not swapping them constantly to disk based on the workload patterns.
Okay. So you've brought up Influx a couple of times. One of the things that Influx did when they came out was cluster, and then they said, you know what, we can't sustain the business model. Single node, and if you want clustering, that depends. Are you guys going open source across the board?
We plan to open source our cluster version.
What about high
availability? How do you achieve high availability when all the road goes down? So the mechanism, this is not something that we've released yet. We are actively working on it. The mechanism is going to be perhaps not surprising. There are two different ways. One is that you could use, if you're okay with asynchronous replication, you could use Postgres's existing replication thing. The other thing is we'll probably add some support for two-phase commit to give us really active high availability.
So the asynchronous replication is working with Citus as a committee. The question is that how does your optimizer know if one of the nodes has failed over and another one has taken over? Is that now that is going to answer all the queries? Because
I think if we ended up doing the active two-phase commit, we're going to build some of that complexity ourselves. That's actually where a lot of our background is from. As an academic, my background is in distributed systems and thinking a lot about various ways you do consistency.
Do you support distributed joins?
So one thing I said that we do not yet support is joins between two hypertables, which would, in the case, be distributed joins.
And those are based on partition.
Sorry? Let me rephrase that. We support them. They are not efficient.
So you have no shuffling data?
Currently not. But let me follow on one thing. The one caveat, again, going back to the time series constraints, is that a join that has a predicate, it would still take into account the constraints in the predicate. So if your distributed join, for example, is related to two hypertables by time, you know, you would actually exclude a lot of the chunks that you need to shuffle, and so you wouldn't be shuffling your entire table. You would, of course, be narrowed it down by the constraints you'd be able to read from the query, if that makes sense. So if you want to do a distributed join on the last week's worth of data, this is a much smaller data problem than a distributed join over all of your hypertables across all time.
Do you have partitioning, virtual partitioning, or physical partitioning? So one table per server?
No, there are many
partitions on.
Yes. So we support, if you look at this picture, yes. You could have many partitions, many tables, many partitions on each server. And again, one of the reasons you would do that is because this time notion, this allows you to eliminate them, but it also even supports things like your data retention policy. We support data retention by just dropping partitions, which is a different problem than you get in most like partitionings. We want to drop a week old, so we avoid all problems with vacuuming. Let me get back to you.
That would be rare, and that's kind of
let me get back to you on that. Let me get back to you. Other engineers will be able to answer your question better.
You presented this in terms of two dimensions, time and space. Time marches strictly forward.
Yep.
But what if? How can I think of this in full generality? If I have more than two dimensions, if all of my dimensions can go incrementally backwards as well as forwards. For example, if I'm monitoring a number of different parameters in the nuclear power plant,
yep.
Or if I'm monitoring something in the financial markets where I've got pricing information going up and down from various sources, and I want to relate them to each other, not necessarily relate them to the forward marching time, would this at least the ability to reduce two of the dimensions and partition automatically provide some advantage in that kind of a scenario?
I'm not sure I understand your question. So the question was along the lines of, time always marches forward. I expressed one other dimension which was used for partitioning that might not march forward. The aspect of when you think of, I guess I don't fully answer your question. Let me try to answer something. And then afterwards, you could talk to me if that doesn't answer. So typically, when we think of this partitioning, it is defined. Animation, slow down. It is not defined strictly on offsets. Like Q to U here is just trying to give you an example. You're generally defining over the space. So you, of course, could add, this defines the entire universe of that key, right? So it's not like you're saying, let me track this 50 sensors. You're like, I divide my ID space into portions, and all the existing sensors hash map into that space. So of course, with power, you could add more or less thing. In terms of analyzing back and forth with time, if you could express it with SQL, you could do that type of, you could do a query on it. Beyond that, I'm not sure I actually understood what you were asking.
And I apologize.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone, for coming. We have a nice
Thank you.